Hi. In this video, I'd like to take a look at what Aquinas says about the virtue of thankfulness, or gratitude. I'll put the text on the screen, read through it, and offer some brief comments and observations. Here we go. Here we are in the second part of the second part, question 106, thankfulness or gratitude. Aquinas writes, "We must now consider thankfulness or gratitude and ingratitude. Concerning thankfulness, there are 6 points of inquiry. First, whether thankfulness is a special virtue distinct from other virtues. Second, who owes more thanks to God, the innocent or the penitent? Third, whether man is always bound to give thanks for human favors. Fourth, whether thanksgiving should be deferred. Fifth, whether thanksgiving should be measured according to the favor received or the disposition of the giver. And sixth, whether one ought to pay back more than one has received." So let's take a look at Article 1. Whether thankfulness is a special virtue distinct from other virtues. Now I'll say, this is an important question because if thankfulness is not its own virtue, if it doesn't describe a particular defined area of the moral life, it would be just another name for things we do elsewhere under other virtues, other aspects of the moral life. It might be part of justice or part of friendship. So the appropriate practice of thankfulness would be considered more thoroughly and more appropriately during a more comprehensive consideration of those virtues of which it's a part. But if thankfulness, if there's a particular area of the moral life which is the practice of thankfulness, then we ought to be able to, as Aquinas will do in this article, give a specific account of what the duties and obligations of thankfulness are. So Aquinas' answer to this question is going to be, yes, it is. Let's take a look at the objections. First objection, it seems that thankfulness is not a special virtue, distinct from other virtues, for we have received the greatest benefits from God and from our parents. Now the honor which we pay to God in return belongs to the virtue of religion, and the honor which we repay our parents belongs to the virtue of piety. Therefore, thankfulness or gratitude is not distinct from the other virtues. This covers roughly the point I was trying to make just a moment ago, that if paying back our thanks to God is the virtue of religion, paying back thanks to our parents is the virtue of piety. So it might be that for every particular relationship in which we give thanks, there is some complete treatment of that relationship that will give us an account of what that kind of thankfulness is and should be. And so there's no need for a separate treatment of gratitude as a virtue in its own right. Second objection. Furthermore, proportionate repayment belongs to commutative justice, according to the philosopher. Now, the purpose of giving thanks is repayment. Therefore, thanksgiving, which belongs to gratitude, is an act of justice. Therefore, gratitude is not a special virtue distinct from the other virtues. And more specifically, it's part of justice, of commutative justice, of repaying what we owe. Third objection. Further, acknowledgement of favor received is requisite for the preservation of friendship, according to the philosopher. Now, friendship is associated with all the virtues, since they are the reason for which a man is loved. Therefore, thankfulness or gratitude, to which it belongs to repay favors received, is not a special virtue. In this case, it's simply a part of friendship, or it's connected with the virtues that are associated with friendship. On the contrary, Tully reckons thankfulness a special part of justice. So, let's see Aquinas' answer. As stated above, the nature of the debt to be paid must needs vary according to various causes giving rise to the debt, yet so that the greater always includes the lesser. Now the cause of debt is found primarily and chiefly in God, in that he is the first principle of all our goods. Secondarily, it is found in our Father, because he is the proximate principle of our begetting and upbringing. Third, it is found in the person that excels in dignity, from whom general favors proceed. Fourth, it is found in a benefactor, from whom we have received particular and private favors, on account of which we are under particular obligation to him. Now, this is interesting. What we have here, in a sense, is a kind of fourfold hierarchy of causes of gratitude. What is it that people give us that causes us to be thankful, to repay a debt of gratitude to them? Well, first and foremost, obviously, God, the kind of ontological giver, the one who brings us into being. We owe a sort of supreme debt to God. That would be that he would be due worship then as the result of that. We owe then a debt to our parents, to our father, he says, for being the kind of proximate cause of our being here in the order of nature, for bringing us into being in that way. And then, interestingly, to rulers, to excellent people, to people of high office and high character and dignity, from whom general favors proceed, people who make the world better by the way that they are, we owe a kind of gratitude to them for the sort of favors that they radiate, the benefits that accrue to the human race because of them and their activity and their rule. And then lastly, a benefactor from whom each of us has received some particular private favor or obligation. So sort of like the fourth rank of gratitude is the person who's done something specific for me as an individual. And this is going to turn out to be where the virtue of gratitude is relevant for Aquinas. Next paragraph. Accordingly, since what we owe God, or our father, or a person excelling in dignity, is not the same as what we owe a benefactor from whom we have received some particular favor, it follows that after religion, whereby we repay God due worship, and piety, whereby we worship our parents, and observance, whereby we worship persons excelling in dignity, there is, fourth rank, thankfulness or gratitude, whereby we give thanks to our benefactors. And it is distinct from the foregoing virtues, just as each of these is distinct from the one that precedes, as falling short thereof. So just as the cause is lesser at each successive rank, the gratitude owed is less at each successive rank. The treatment of observance, which he calls this virtue related to excellent people, is dealt with up here in question 102. Maybe we'll take a look at that another time. Replies to the objections, then. First, just as religion is super excelling piety, so it is excelling thankfulness or gratitude. Wherefore, giving thanks to God, it was reckoned above as among the things pertaining to religion. Okay, keep in mind, what he's done here is he's carved out the space for gratitude in this fourth rank of debts that we owe to our specific benefactors. So he's free to assign the debt we pay to God to religion and worship, the debt we pay to our parents to piety, etc., and to say what's left over are our specific debts to our specific benefactors. That's where we practice the virtue of gratitude or thankfulness. Second objection, reply. Proportionate repayment belongs to commutative justice when it answers to the legal due. For instance, when it is contracted that so much be paid for so much. But the repayment that belongs to the virtue of thankfulness or gratitude answers to the moral debt and is paid spontaneously. Hence, thanksgiving is less thankful when compelled, as Seneca observes. So the distinction I think Aquinas makes here is between a legal contract where one pays what is required and what is contracted, and the payment of a moral debt which is spontaneous and which has a different sort of character. It doesn't have to be proportionate. And the reply to the third objection, since true friendship is based on virtue, whatever there is contrary to virtue in a friend is an obstacle to friendship, and whatever in him is virtuous is an incentive to friendship. In this way, friendship is preserved by the repayment of favors, although repayment of favors belongs especially to the virtue of gratitude. Again, we would say, yes, gratitude is included in friendship, but is not completely included in friendship. It deserves its own treatment here in the rest of this question. Article 2. Whether the innocent is more bound to give thanks to God than the penitent? First objection. It seems that the innocent is more bound to give thanks to God than the penitent. For the greater the gift one has received from God, the more one is bound to give him thanks. Now, the gift of innocence is greater than that of justice restored. Therefore, it seems that the innocent is more bound to give thanks to God than the penitent. You might think, thinking theologically, you might ask, would a person who had been preserved in pure innocence from sin, the Virgin Mary or the woman in the novel Paralandra, be of right more grateful to God for maintaining that innocence than the person who has fallen away and then been forgiven and restored to God's grace by God's action? Second objection. Further, a man owes love to his benefactor just as he owes him gratitude. Now, Augustine says, what man weighing his own infirmity would dare to ascribe his purity and innocence to his own strength, that he should so love thee the less, as if he had needed less thy mercy, whereby thou remittest sins to those that turn to thee? And farther on he says, and for this let him love thee as much, yea, and more, since by whom he sees me to have been recovered from such deep torpor of sin, by him he sees himself to have been from the like torpor of sin preserved. Therefore the innocent is also more bound to give thanks than the penitent. Third objection. Further, the more a gratuitous favor is continuous, the greater the thanksgiving due for it. Now the favor of divine grace is more continuous in the innocent than in the penitent. For Augustine says, to thy grace I ascribe it, and to thy mercy that thou hast melted away my sins as it were ice. To thy grace I ascribe also whatsoever I have not done of evil, for what might I not have done? Yea, all I confess to have been forgiven me, both what evils I committed by my own willfulness, and what by thy guidance committed not. Therefore the innocent is more bound to give thanks than the penitent. I think this is an interesting observation, that we might say that the innocent, by avoiding all sin, has been preserved by God's grace from a greater quantity of error than the penitent person who's fallen into at least one sin and then been restored to God's good graces. So it seems fitting that the innocent should be more thankful than the penitent. On the contrary, it is written in the gospel, to whom more is forgiven, he loveth more. Therefore, for the same reason, he is bound to greater thanksgiving. So what's the solution to this problem? Aquinas' solution? I answer that thanksgiving, gratiarum actio, in the recipient, corresponds to the favor, the gratia, of the giver, so that when there is greater favor on the part of the giver, greater thanks are due on the part of the recipient. Now, a favor is something bestowed gratis, wherefore, on the part of the giver, the favor may be greater on two counts. First, owing to the quantity of the thing given, and in this way, the innocent owes greater thanksgiving because he received a greater gift from God. Also, absolutely speaking, a more continuous gift, other things being equal. Second, a favor may be said to be greater because it is given more gratuitously. And in this sense, the penitent is more bound to give thanks than the innocent, because what he receives from God is more gratuitously given, since whereas he was deserving of punishment, he has received grace. You might say that distinguishes the penitent from the innocent, who is not deserving of punishment. Wherefore, although the gift bestowed on the innocent is considered absolutely greater, yet the gift bestowed on the penitent is greater in relation to him, even as a small gift bestowed upon a poor man is greater to him than a great gift is to a rich man. And since actions are about singulars, in matters of action we have to take note of what is such here and now, rather than of what is such absolutely, as the philosopher observes, in treating of the voluntary and of the involuntary. And this suffices for the replies to the objections. I'm really interested in this distinction that Aquinas makes between what is greater absolutely, which might be to be preserved entirely from sin, like Mary or like the woman in Paralandra, and what is greater in relation to the recipient, the individual, which is to have punishment dispensed and to be restored to the good graces of God. That is given, in a sense, more gratuitously, although the magnitude of the gift itself is not greater. So, an interesting distinction here to undo the idea that the innocent should be more grateful than the person who is forgiven by God. Let's take a look at Article 3. Whether a man is bound to give thanks to every benefactor. First objection. It seems that a man is not bound to give thanks to every benefactor, for a man may benefit himself, just as he may harm himself. According to Ecclesiasticus, he that is evil to himself, to whom will he be good? But a man cannot thank himself, since thanksgiving seems to pass from one person to another. Therefore, thanksgiving is not due to every benefactor. Okay, this is maybe a kind of trivial singular case. If you benefit yourself, you don't owe thanks to yourself. So it's wrong to say in a general sense that every benefactor is owed gratitude. Second objection. Further, gratitude is a repayment of an act of grace. But some favors are granted without grace and are rudely, slowly, and grudgingly given. Therefore, gratitude is not always due to a benefactor. A benefactor who helps us, but in a rude or slow or grudging way, doesn't seem that we owe him gratitude, do we? Okay. Third objection. Further, no thanks are due to one who works for his own profit. But sometimes people bestow favors for their own profit, and therefore thanks are not due to them. Okay, so if somebody gives me a gift or benefits me, but really with his own self-interest in mind, it doesn't seem, on this reasoning, that I should owe that person a debt of gratitude or thankfulness, if he was just seeking to benefit himself by benefiting me. Fourth objection. Further, no thanks are due to a slave, for all that he is belongs to his master. Yet sometimes a slave does a good turn to his master, and therefore gratitude is not due to every benefactor. I think Aquinas is appealing here to the idea that this radical difference in social station and moral desert, nobody would feel that they had to thank a slave, and therefore it's not, again, the general rule that thanks is due to every benefactor would not be the case. Fifth objection. Further, no one is bound to do what he cannot do equitably and advantageously. Now, it happens at times that the benefactor is very well off, and it would be of no advantage to him to be repaid for a favor he has bestowed. Again, it happens sometimes that the benefactor, from being virtuous, has become wicked, so that it would not seem equitable to repay him. Also, the recipient of a favor may be a very poor man and is quite unable to repay. Therefore, seemingly, a man is not always bound to repayment for favors received. Okay? Another objection to the idea that there's a general rule about repaying every benefactor. Right? Should a poor man repay somehow in a debt of gratitude the rich man who wouldn't profit at all from the repayment? Sixth objection. Further, no one is bound to do for another what is inexpedient and hurtful to him. Now, sometimes it happens that repayment of a favor would be hurtful or useless to the person repaid. Therefore, favors are not always to be repaid by gratitude. Now, you might think of returning an item or money to somebody at a time and under circumstances in which they would make poor use of it, or would be harmed by it. I might say, in that case, certainly I ought not to repay my debt of gratitude. On the contrary, it is written, in all things give thanks. So what's Aquinas' solution here? I answer that every effect turns naturally to its cause. Wherefore Dionysius says that God turns all things to himself because he is the cause of all. For the effect must needs always be directed to the end of the agent. Now it is evident that a benefactor as such is the cause of the beneficiary. Hence the natural order requires that he who has received a favor should, by repaying the favor, turn to his benefactor according to the mode of each. And as stated above with regard to the father, a man owes his benefactor as such honor and reverence, since the latter stands to him in the relation of a principal, but accidentally he owes him assistance and support if he need it. Okay. So what do we owe to a benefactor? Honor and reverence, and then accidentally, if possible, if needed, assistance and support. So there's this kind of separation, I think, between the different obligations one has to a benefactor. Reply to the first objection. In the words of Seneca, just as a man is liberal who gives not only to himself but to others, and gracious who forgives not himself but others, and merciful who is moved not by his own misfortunes but by another's, so too, no man confers a favor on himself he is but following the bent of his nature, which moves him to resist what hurts him and to seek what is profitable. Wherefore, in things that one does for oneself, there is no place for gratitude or ingratitude, since a man cannot deny himself a thing except by keeping it. In other words, you can't be grateful to yourself. You can't tickle yourself. It's just one of those things that's not reflexive in that way. Nevertheless, things which are properly spoken of in relation to others are spoken of metaphorically in relation to oneself, as the philosopher states regarding justice, insofar, to wit, as the various parts of man are considered as though they were various persons. So part of the response to objection one is that we're speaking metaphorically when we talk about being grateful to yourself or repaying a debt to yourself. In fact, when you act for yourself, you're acting in your own self-interest, not properly out of a sense of gratitude. Reply to objection two. It is the mark of a happy disposition to see good rather than evil. Wherefore, if someone has conferred a favor, not as he ought to have conferred it, the recipient should not for that reason withhold his thanks. Yet he owes less thanks than if the favor had been conferred duly, since in fact the favor is less, for as Seneca remarks, promptness enhances, delay discounts a favor. So if somebody gives us a gift, gives us a is our benefactor, but grudgingly or rudely or slowly, this only affects the manner in which we've received the gift. It doesn't dispense us from the obligation to repay the gift. It might make the gift a little bit less lower in quality than it might have been if it had been given freely and properly. Okay, but this doesn't change the fact that there is an obligation of thankfulness there for us. Reply to the third objection. As Seneca observes, it matters much whether a person does a kindness to us for his own sake or for ours or for both his and ours. He that considers himself only and benefits us because he cannot otherwise benefit himself seems to me like a man who seeks fodder for his cattle. And farther on, if he has done it for me in common with himself, having both of us in mind, I am ungrateful and not merely unjust unless I rejoice that what was profitable to him is profitable to me also. It is the height of malevolence to refuse to recognize a kindness unless the giver has been the loser thereby. I think that's a really fantastic point. Aquinas doesn't elaborate on this quote from Seneca, but let me give my own poor attempt. If a person benefits us seeking only his own interest, it seems that this is like seeking fodder for cattle. I don't think I would owe gratitude there. But if he seeks both of our benefits, and by benefiting himself benefits me, it seems that I am obligated. In fact, I would be malevolent, the suggestion is, if I did not rejoice at least at the fact that his self-interest aligned with a benefit to me, what benefited him benefited me. I think that's a great thing to keep in mind in our own age. It is the height of malevolence to refuse to recognize a kindness unless the giver has been the loser thereby. Something very anti-Kantian in this, it seems. He doesn't have to lose in order for me to gain and also to recognize that I've been benefited and be appropriately thankful. Reply to the fourth objection regarding the slave. As Seneca observes, when a slave does what is wanted to be demanded of a slave, it is part of his service. But when he does more than a slave is bound to do, it is a favor. For as soon as he does anything from a motive of friendship, if indeed that be his motive, it is no longer called service. Wherefore, gratitude is due even to a slave when he does more than his duty. And this, I think, helps us to remember the moral agency even of slaves, that they are obligated, it seems, in service to do what is demanded of them, but if they go beyond, then they are no longer serving but are acting out of their own free will, out of friendship, and that should call forth a response of gratitude from the people who are benefited by it. There are, of course, many references to slavery in Scripture. There's the one discussion where the people say, we are unprofitable servants, we have done only what has been demanded of us. There's a suggestion here, I think, in the spiritual order that by doing more than is required, by being not just a servant, but a good servant of God, one can go enter into friendship, to go beyond simply what is obligatory into something that is greater than that. So there's the reply to objection 4 and the reply to objection 5. A poor man is certainly not ungrateful if he does what he can. For since kindness depends on the heart rather than on the deed, so too gratitude depends chiefly on the heart. Hence Seneca says, "Who receives a favor gratefully has already begun to pay it back, and that we are grateful for favors received should be shown by the outpourings of the heart, not only in his hearing but everywhere." From this it is evident that however well off a man may be, it is possible to thank him for his kindness by showing him reverence and honor. Wherefore the philosopher says, "He that abounds should be repaid with honor. He that is in want should be repaid with money." And Seneca writes, "There are many ways of repaying those who are well off, whatever we happen to owe them, such as good advice, frequent fellowship, affable and pleasant conversation without flattery. Therefore, there is no need for a man to desire neediness and distress in his benefactor before repaying his kindness, because as Seneca says, it were inhuman to desire this in one from whom you have received no favor, how much more so to desire it in one whose kindness has made you his debtor." Okay. We don't look to the neediness of our benefactor before deciding whether or not we should repay him. Okay. And this seems to me to be a very good point. If, however, a benefactor has lapsed from virtue, nevertheless, he should be repaid according to his state, that he may return to virtue if possible. But if he be so wicked as to be incurable, then his heart has changed, and consequently no repayment is due for his kindness as heretofore. And yet, as far as is possible without sin, the kindness he has shown should be held in memory, as the philosopher says. Something I forgot to mention a moment ago, we can always repay those better off than us with honor, with respect, with friendship, with good advice, with things that are not costly to us. So there's not a question here of the poor repaying the rich, or being prohibited from repaying the rich by their circumstance. This last paragraph, if a benefactor has slipped into wickedness, he still should be repaid that he might return to virtue. And it's only if the case that he is so wicked that he's irredeemable, right, incurable, then one would not owe this to him. It's not owe the debt of gratitude to him. It's not clear to me just how wicked someone would have to be considered incurable. And even in that circumstance, the kind of external appearance of repayment seems to still be obligatory. We should at least hold his kindness in memory, even if we're unable to repay him because of his current depravity. So if repaying the debt could potentially be an assistance in restoring the benefactor to virtue, it should still be paid. If that's not possible, the kindness should be held in memory, presumably with the idea of repaying it when it can be repaid without danger or at a better time for the benefactor. Reply to the 6th objection. As stated in the preceding reply, repayment of a favor depends chiefly on the affection of the heart. Wherefore, repayment should be made in such a way as to prove most beneficial. If, however, through the benefactor's carelessness, it proved detrimental to him, this is not imputed to the person who repays him, as Seneca observes. It is my duty to repay and not to keep back and safeguard my repayment. Okay. If I owe a debt of gratitude, I should repay it. I should not be trying to calculate about whether and when my repayment would be most advantageous to my benefactor. Let's go to Article 4. Whether a man is bound to repay a favor at once. First objection, it seems that a man is bound to repay a favor at once, for we are bound to restore at once what we owe, unless the term be fixed. Now, there is no term prescribed for the repayment of favors, yet this repayment is a duty as stated above. Therefore, a man is bound to repay a favor at once. Okay? It's not like a contract where there's a term of delivery. Once I receive a favor, I should immediately turn around and repay that favor in gratitude. Second objection. Further, a good action would seem to be all the more praiseworthy according as it is done with greater earnestness. Now, earnestness seems to make a man do his duty without any delay. Therefore, it is apparently more praiseworthy to repay a favor at once. Okay, the more earnestly, the more eagerly I repay my favor, the better my action is, and therefore it would seem that, other things being equal, the earlier repayment is preferable to the later. Third objection. Further, as Seneca says, it is proper to a benefactor to act free and quickly. Now, repayment ought to equal the favor received, therefore it should be done at once. Okay, just as the benefactor, it acts freely and quickly, the person repaying in gratitude should act freely and quickly. On the contrary, Seneca says, he that hastens to repay is animated with a sense not of gratitude, but of indebtedness. Aquinas' solution? I answer that, just as in conferring a favor, two things are to be considered, namely the affection of the heart and the gift, so also must these things be considered in repaying the favor. As regards the affection of the heart, repayment should be made at once, wherefore Seneca says, do you wish to repay a favor? Receive it graciously. Okay, so the obligation of the heart of sentiment is due immediately. As regards the gift, one ought to wait until such a time as will be convenient to the benefactor. In fact, if, instead of choosing a convenient time, one wished to repay at once, favor for favor, it would seem not to be virtuous, but a constrained repayment. For as Seneca observes, he that wishes to repay too soon is an unwilling debtor, and an unwilling debtor is ungrateful. Okay, so here, an appeal may be to prudence or fittingness. If you wish to repay, repay at the convenience of the benefactor. If you demand to repay at your own convenience, being immediate, it seems that you somehow violate the trust, that the relationship that exists between the benefactor and yourself as his debtor. Reply to the first objection. A legal debt must be paid at once, else the equality of justice would not be preserved if one kept another's property without his consent. Okay, we're thinking back to the contractual model from before. But a moral debt depends on the equity of the debtor, and therefore it should be repaid in due time according as the rectitude of virtue demands. Okay, so a distinction between legal obligation and moral obligation. The latter is the category of gratitude and its debts. Reply to the second objection, earnestness of will is not virtuous unless it be regulated by reason. Wherefore, it is not praiseworthy to forestall the proper time through earnestness. And again, if there is an appropriate time to repay the debt, that is going to be determined by reason, by prudential judgment. If you become earnest to repay the debt immediately for your own reasons, you seem to be violating the canon of reason and then departing from the path of virtue. Reply to the third objection. Favors also should be conferred at a convenient time, and one should no longer delay when the convenient time comes, and the same is to be observed in repaying favors. Okay, so if we're to imitate the benefactor in our repayment, the benefactor gives the favor at a time and in a manner that is most advantageous to the recipient, the same should be the case with the recipient's repayment of a debt of gratitude. It doesn't have to be immediate, it could be delayed to an appropriate time, and that's simply when the right time comes, that's when the debt should be paid. Article 5. Whether in giving thanks we should look at the benefactor's disposition or at the deed. First objection. It seems that in repaying favors, we should not look at the benefactor's disposition, but at the deed. For repayment is due to beneficence, and beneficence consists in deeds, as the word itself denotes, right? Benefice, right? To do good. Therefore, in repaying favors, we should look to the deed. Second objection, further thanksgiving, whereby we repay favors, is a part of justice. But justice considers equality between giving and taking. Therefore, also in repaying favors, we should consider the deed rather than the disposition of the benefactor. That is, we should aim to repay an equal quantity to what we've received. Objection 3. Further, no one can consider what he does not know. Now, God alone knows the interior disposition of a man's heart. Therefore, it is impossible for humans to repay a favor according to the benefactor's disposition. We simply don't know that. We can't see into his heart, so I can't repay him according to what his disposition, what his thought and intention was. I should only pay attention to the actual observable facts of the gift. On the contrary, Seneca says, we are sometimes under a greater obligation to one who has given little, with a large heart, and has bestowed a small favor, yet willingly. It does seem here that there is a problem with these objections. So let's take a look at Aquinas' solution. I answer that the repayment of a favor may belong to three virtues, namely justice, gratitude, and friendship. It belongs to justice when the repayment has the character of a legal debt, as in a loan and the like. And in such cases, repayment must be according to the quantity received. Okay, if I borrow $1,000 from you, I'm obligated to repay you $1,000 and whatever we've contractually agreed to in addition. On the other hand, repayment of a favor belongs, though in different ways, to friendship and likewise to the virtue of gratitude. When it has the character of a moral debt. For in the repayment of friendship, we have to consider the cause of friendship, so that in the friendship that is based on the useful, repayment should be made according to the usefulness accruing from the favor conferred. And in the friendship based upon virtue, repayment should be made with regard to the choice or disposition of the giver, since this is the chief requisite of virtue, as stated in Ethics 8. And likewise, since gratitude regards the favor inasmuch as it is bestowed gratis, and this regards the disposition of the giver, it follows again that the repayment of a favor depends more on the disposition of the giver than on the effect. So, a couple of things happening here. One, he separates out repayment according to justice, that's governed by law, legal debts, set those aside, those are not moral debts. Moral debts can either be debts of, related to the virtue of friendship or of gratitude the relation to benefactors. If it's friendship, it could be a friendship of utility, where it should be paid then according to the usefulness of what's been given. Think of the Aristotle's distinction of the different kinds of friendship. If it's a friendship of virtue, however, then we repay it with regard to the choice or disposition of the giver, since that's what's involved in virtue. So if I owe somebody repayment under the virtue of friendship, if our friendship is a friendship of virtue, suddenly the disposition, the mental state, the intention of the person I'm repaying matters. So the question at stake here can be answered on that basis. Additionally, gratitude, this virtue we've been talking about here, this relation to benefactors, since it regards the favor as bestowed gratis, well, what is gratis? Gratis is, you know, a certain kind of intention, a certain kind of disposition of the giver. So obviously that is relevant to calculating my repayment and offering appropriate repayment. Okay. Reply to the first objection. Every moral act depends upon the will. Hence, a kindly action, insofar as it is praiseworthy and is deserving of gratitude, consists materially in the thing done, but formally and chiefly in the will. Hence Seneca says, a kindly action consists not in deed or gift, but in the disposition of the giver or doer. And again, we're reminded here that moral as opposed to legal debts and acts have this character of involving the disposition and the will of the person who has bestowed them. That's obviously relevant then to our repayment. Reply to the second objection. Gratitude is a part of justice, not indeed as a species, as part of a genus, but by a kind of reduction to the genus of justice, as stated above. Hence, it does not follow that we shall find the same kind of debt in both virtues. And without going too far into the question 80, it seems that the answer here is that gratitude is a part of justice, it's relevant to justice, but it's not an entirely contained subpart of justice. So in being grateful and repaying according to gratitude, we are being just, but it is not Our gratitude is not exhausted by a consideration of justice. It does not follow that we have the exact same kind of debt that we owe in justice as we owe in gratitude. And reply to the third objection. God alone sees man's disposition in itself, but insofar as it is shown by certain signs, man also can know it. It is thus that a benefactor's disposition is known by the way in which he does the kindly action. For instance, through his doing it joyfully and readily. So we can put aside the idea that we need to be able to see into the person's heart to know sort of completely, comprehensively, purely what their intention was. As with all other human interactions, we read it off of their behavior and the manner in which they have done something. So if they give joyfully and readily, we can use that to determine their disposition. So we don't have this sort of absolute ignorance problem that the third objection suggested. Final article of this question, Article 6. Whether the repayment of gratitude should surpass the favor received. First objection. It seems that there is no need for the repayment of gratitude to surpass the favor received, for it is not possible to make even equal repayment to some, for instance, one's parents, as the philosopher states. Now, virtue does not attempt the impossible, therefore gratitude for a favor does not tend to something yet greater. The question here in the article seems to be whether our repayment of debts in gratitude should aim at exactly what we were given, or should aim necessarily to exceed what we were given. And Aquinas is going to argue, yes, we should try to exceed it. The first objection is for the view that no, we need not, because how can you possibly repay your parents for bringing you into existence? You can't bring them into existence. Okay? Same would hold true even more so with respect to the debt one owes to God. So it would seem that at the very most you could try to achieve, come close to, or equal, but certainly not to try to exceed the favor that's been given. Second objection. Further, if one person repays another more than he has received by his favor, by that very fact, he gives him something his turn, as it were. But the latter owes him repayment for the favor which in his turn the former has conferred on him. Right? So if you give me 100, I give you back 110, suddenly now you owe me gratitude for the extra 10. You pay me that, that, and that. We have a problem here. Therefore, that he that first conferred a favor will be bound to yet a greater repayment, and so on indefinitely. Now, virtue does not strive at the indefinite, since the indefinite removes the nature of good. Therefore, repayment of gratitude should not surpass the favor received. The suggestion here being perhaps that we get into an arms race of repayment. If I pay more than you gave me, you have to pay me back in recognition of the more, and each of us is constantly outdoing the other. This doesn't seem to be compatible with virtue and rational governance of our lives. This like constantly escalating one-upsmanship. Third objection. Further, justice consists in equality, but more is excess of equality. Since, therefore, excess is sinful in every virtue, it seems that to repay more than the favor received is sinful and opposed to virtue. So if we think of justice as being bringing back a kind of equality that maybe not exist at the moment, we should think that to exceed that is necessarily to miss the mark. On the contrary, the philosopher says, we should repay those who are gracious to us by being gracious to them in return. And this is done by repaying more than we have received. Therefore, gratitude should incline to do something greater. Okay, a note here is that we should incline to, we should aim to, not always necessarily do so. I answer that, as stated above in Article 5, gratitude regards the favor received according to the intention of the benefactor, who seems to be deserving of praise chiefly for having conferred the favor gratis without being bound to do so. Wherefore, the beneficiary is under a moral obligation to bestow something gratis in return. Now, he does not seem to bestow something gratis unless he exceeds the quantity of the favor received, because so long as he repays less or an equivalent, he would seem to do nothing gratis, but only to return what he has received. Therefore, gratitude always inclines, as far as possible, to pay back something more. Okay, the very nature of gratitude is that we try to go beyond what we have received rather than simply to restore what we have received. We always aim at giving 110 in return for 100. But what's crucial here is the gratuity. It's the gratis nature, both of what has been received and then what is paid back by the grateful person. Reply to the first objection. As stated above, in repaying favors, we must consider the disposition rather than the deed. Accordingly, if we consider the effect of beneficence, which a son receives from his parents, namely to be and to live, the son cannot make an equal repayment, as the philosopher states. But if we consider the will of the giver and of the repayer, then it is possible for the son to pay back something greater to his father, as Seneca declares. If, however, he were unable to do so, the will to pay back would be sufficient for gratitude. And that's an interesting observation, right? Certainly, the son cannot equal or exceed his father's gift to him, but if we simply consider the will, right, what he wants to give, what he chooses, what he wills to give, his will to honor, to respect, to show piety for his father, it is possible to pay back something greater. So he doesn't specify what that greater is. We might speculate about that a little bit ourselves. How does a child repay to the parent with a sort of greater will, a greater love, perhaps? Reply to the second objection. The debt of gratitude flows from charity, which the more it is paid, the more it is due, according to Romans. Owe no man anything but to love one another. Wherefore, it is not unreasonable if the obligation of gratitude has no limit. So if we've entered the order of will and of love here, to repay what one has received in love with still greater love on the part of yourself, that's to start maybe a kind of one-upsmanship, a kind of arms race, but it's an arms race in the realm of morals, in the realm of the will. It's not the kind of thing that is contrary to reason, that I should try to love you still greater in response to your love for me, and that then you, having received this greater love from me, should try to love me still the more. There's nothing wrong or irrational about that kind of a cycle. So it's not contrary to reason, even though it would be maybe a kind of arms race or one-upsmanship. Okay, in love, in the will, that seems to be fine. And finally, reply to the third objection. As in justice, which is a cardinal virtue, we consider equality of things, so in gratitude we consider the equality of wills. For while on the one hand the benefactor of his own free will gave something that he was not bound to give, so on the other hand the beneficiary repays something over and above what he has received. Again, I think the emphasis here is on the gratuity of the will, the gratuity of the act of giving, and the motivation to the intention, the love with which the giver, the grateful person, gives back to and repays the benefactor. So that's the end of question 106. Question 107 deals with ingratitude. We might talk about that at another time. So that's my look at some length at question 106 of the second part of the second part of Aquinas' Summa on the virtue of thankfulness or gratitude. Thanks for watching today. Goodbye.